Well, thank you very much, Mr. Chairman, and I appreciate all of your opening remarks. And let me at the outset thank you so much for your leadership of this subcommittee while I've been Assistant Secretary. It's been a real pleasure to work with you, and I can tell you everybody at the State Department and in the Obama administration appreciates the energy and dedication that you have brought to helping to enhance our cooperation and our engagement with Central Asia. You mentioned your leadership in establishing the Central Asia Caucus, but you've also been a frequent traveler to the region and have really helped to raise the profile of this very important country. And of course, we wish you well. We look forward to continuing to work with you, and of course, to Mr. Manzullo and his colleagues as they enter into the majority.
We're not leaving.
I have a longer statement for the record, with your permission.
Without objection, both of your statements were made part of the record. If you have any related materials that you want to submit for the record also, it will be.
Thank you so much. Mr. Chairman, Central Asia, as you say, lies at a very critical strategic crossroads bordering Afghanistan, China, Russia, and Iran, which is why the United States wants to continue to expand our engagement and our cooperation with this critical region. We have identified five main priorities for our engagement in Central Asia. First, to assist coalition efforts in Afghanistan, to increase the development of the region's energy resources and diversification of supply routes, encourage political liberalization, enhance respect for human rights, to foster competitive market economies and openings for our businesses, and also to increase the capacity of states to govern themselves effectively and serve the needs of their citizens. Mr. Chairman, we don't see ourselves in competition for influence with any other country, nor do we accept that the five Central Asian countries constitute an exclusive zone of interest for any country. To the contrary, we want to cooperate more with Russia, China, and others to address the critical challenges and produce a more durable stability and more reliable partners for everyone. Central Asia has, in fact, been an area of common ground for us to engage with Russia and to further the reset of our relations with Russia, especially regarding Kyrgyzstan, where they have really been key partners. In order to pursue our goals, Mr. Chairman, we've developed in partnership with each of the countries in the region structured annual bilateral consultations that I lead to elevate, enhance, and energize our dialogue with each of the countries of Central Asia. So let me just briefly highlight some of the key issues with each of these countries. Starting with Kyrgyzstan, the situation in the Kyrgyz Republic remains of vital interest to the United States. As you know, Mr. Chairman, on October 10th, the Kyrgyz Republic held Central Asia's first truly free parliamentary elections in which the outcome was not known in advance. And we're now encouraging the leaders of the five parties there that qualified for seats to cooperate to form an inclusive representative government. The United States played a very active role in facilitating this democratic achievement through our assistance programs and grants to the Kyrgyz government and civil society and our participation in the election monitoring mission. At the same time, we are supporting the International Commission to investigate the violence that took place in June in southern Kyrgyzstan. This commission is headed by Kimmo Kiljunen, a member of the Finnish parliament. We're also continuing to support an OSCE initiative to improve public security, particularly in the South, to assist in the urgent task of restoring mutual trust and preventing further conflict in that important country. Kyrgyzstan also remains an important partner in our efforts in Afghanistan. The Manas Transit Center represents a key contribution by the Kyrgyz Republic to the efforts of the International Coalition to provide security for the Afghan people. Turning to Kazakhstan, I appreciate your comments on Kazakhstan, Mr. Chairman. As you say, our relations with Kazakhstan are probably our deepest and broadest of any in Central Asia. And since you mentioned it, I'd like to particularly recognize the recent completion of the long-term effort to safely shut down Kazakhstan's BN-350 plutonium production reactor, secure the spent fuel that it produced, and then to transport that fuel to a secure facility. That process has now been completed and marks a real milestone in our nonproliferation cooperation, and I commend Kazakhstan for that. As you say, Mr. Chairman, Kazakhstan's also been a strong supporter of U.S. efforts in Afghanistan. But really, the spotlight is right now on Astana for another reason, because it is the chairman and office of the OSCE, and Kazakhstan's about to host the first OSCE summit in 11 years in Astana on December 1st and 2nd. We think that Kazakhstan has done a very credible job as OSCE chairman in office, especially dealing with the situation in Kyrgyzstan, where the OSCE has really been at the forefront of efforts to promote peace, democracy, and reconciliation. We're also pleased that Kazakhstan has agreed to follow the example of past summits and allow full access by NGOs and permit NGOs to organize a parallel event on November 28th and November 29th. We also encourage Kazakhstan to continue to improve its human rights record and to uphold the commitments it made in taking on this chairmanship. Mr. Chairman, Secretary Clinton plans to lead the U.S. delegation to the OSCE summit, and we hope that to be successful, the summit should produce two key documents. First, a Helsinki Final Act 35th Anniversary Statement that reaffirms all those commitments, and also an ambitious substantive action plan to guide future work of the OSCE. And of course, Mr. Chairman, we'd be delighted to welcome you as part of the U.S. delegation in Astana. Turning to Uzbekistan, as with other countries, the United States has also increased our engagement with that important country. We have a very full agenda of security, economic, and human rights issues that we are working with them on. Uzbekistan is a particularly key partner for the U.S. effort in Afghanistan. It's providing electricity to keep the lights on in Kabul. It's facilitated transit for essential supplies to coalition forces, and it's helped to construct a very important rail line inside Afghanistan. So we've seen an improved relationship with Uzbekistan, but some challenges remain. We continue to encourage the Uzbeks to address significant human rights concerns, such as ending forced child labor, opening up the media environment, and demonstrating greater tolerance for religious activities. In Tajikistan, as you mentioned, Mr. Chairman, it's one of the poorest countries in the world and a fragile state in a volatile neighborhood. Recent skirmishes between the government and the former civil war combatants, as well as security threats, such as the August 25th prison break, really reflect the continued tensions in that country. And the United States is working to strengthen law enforcement and border security, increase food security, as you mentioned, strengthen health and education, and encourage respect for human rights, particularly religious and media freedom. Last but not least, in Turkmenistan, we continue to make progress in facilitating that country's gradual opening up and its efforts to move toward reform and greater respect for human rights. We also appreciate Turkmenistan's humanitarian help in neighboring Afghanistan through its provision of discounted electricity. As part of our first ever annual bilateral consultations in Ashgabat in June, I led the first ever U.S. business mission to Turkmenistan. And this strengthened an important commercial partnership with a nation that now holds the world's fourth largest natural gas reserves. Mr. Chairman, in conclusion, this administration considers Central Asia to be an important pillar of our security policy and regional U.S. interests. We recognize that the pace of change is often slow and that our program should focus on long-term, meaningful results. But through our invigorated policy dialogue and our engagement, we aim to strengthen our ties with these important countries and their people and thereby advance U.S. interests in this strategically important region. And again, I thank you for your personal engagement.